I loved Acid.
Happy New Year, you bad motherfuckers. Joey Diaz, Jayson Thibault, and my main man, the Flying Jew, Lee Syatt, coming directly from our fucking cabana here in Oxnard, California. What's going on, brother?
I'm doing great. Right?
You're feeling good? You're looking good?
I had a fucking tough jiu-jitsu class today.
I didn't want to go at all.
Like, something I'm working on this year is just being more honest and direct. Right now, I hate jiu-jitsu. I don't want to go at all.
Why?
It's the hardest thing I've ever done. It's hard. I'm not good at it. And it's like, I like the elliptical. I don't really sweat on it. And I like kettlebells. But, like, Joey called me today. And, like, it didn't make me go, but, like, talked me into going. And, like, I came up here, like, I should go back to editing. Like, you like, gave me a talking to, and I'm happy I went.
Listen, man, it's not the big things you do. It's the little fucking things you do.
That's it?
When you...
Don't I know.
All right, listen. You want to fucking quit what you're doing and do a 9-to-5, and that's fine. That's fine. But you come to me one day and you go, you know what? I don't want to do a 9-to-5 no more. I want to take fucking photography.
Right.
You have to lead a different life. It's a completely different life. And people go into shell shock. What do you do now? Well, what the fuck do you do? You have to get those things and put them on coffee shops and say you're going to sell headshots, whatever, for $99. You bump into an actor or a comic. You do free headshots. And hopefully the headshots come out good. It's just constantly moving.
Yeah.
You're like a shark. But along the way, you're going to get discouraged. And what happens? You need a family. And sometimes your family's not there. Sometimes your girlfriend don't know what the fuck you're talking about. So you have this little thing. So what do? You go to the gym, you do this, you do that. You and I both know that if we stop fucking working out, we gain 22 pounds in a week.
Oh, easy.
Okay, so now you have to start thinking about your future. You're 28. Your metabolism is already 3/4 fucking cut.
Yeah, I started off at 3/4.
At 3/4. So now, what's your angle? You really mean to tell me you're going to go to 24-hour fitness for the rest of your fucking life? You know what? If you're going to go to 24-hour fitness, you might as well join a martial arts class. And that's your home away from home. Mm. That's your getaway. Every time you hear no, every time you take some scumbag's pictures and he doesn't pay you, or, you know, he doesn't like the sweater he wore, you know what? It's going to be fine because you're going to go to jiu-jitsu and either you're going to get choked or somebody's going to choke the fuck out of you. And it becomes a family. And now, no matter what's going on around you, because even if you're in a program, sometimes you go to a program and you leave there, you go, what a bunch of fucking whiny fucks.
23% of the time.
This is where you go, and nobody knows your business. Nobody knows you do drugs. Nobody knows nothing. All you got to do is do hip escapes, and you're going to get stronger. And then you see people that are 60, and they got a black belt. And you're not out beating people up, but it's peace of mind.
Plus, you also see people that used to be you.
Yeah.
You know, you see people a year in that used to be like, man, all right, that dude talks about, he remembers how I feel now, and like, he has shit together. Like, all right, cool. Like, you know, you get to hang out with the people that have what you want.
And it was nice. I was in a class of all blue belts, which is like the next level up from me.
Mm-hmm.
And one of them sat down with me because we did like a hard class, like a hard like hour and 20 minute class, hour 10 minute class. And towards the end, I just had to like tap out like we were doing some rolling, and one of the blue belts came over and talked to me. I think he thought I was newer than I was, but it was still my problem with jiu-jitsu has never been the people at jiu-jitsu. Everyone's always been nice. It's just
it's fucking hard. They're not giving nothing away.
No.
So what would you rather do, something that's easy or something that's hard? Ari and I had a great conversation there. Ari and I talk at 2 a.m. you know.
Yeah.
So let's say I don't do nothing.
Is noon for Ari, if anybody
It's noon
know.
For Ari.
Yeah.
So especially when he was in New York.
Oh, yeah.
I'd call him at midnight. He's just walking in the fucking door with a slice of pizza. Happy.
Exactly.
Here for me.
I did the
happy
same thing a lot.
3 a.m. And we were talking about when you're a comic, you go through different phases. You go through the 6-year phase, the 10-year phase. Now you start getting a little bit of success. What's success? Not a TV show. People calling you, they're giving you work. They're asking you to be a part of different fucking things, whatever the
and
fuck
money
it is.
Work, too. Money
and
work.
And money work.
Like, you know, let me give you $150 to feature. You're like, wow, that's a big show, and I'm featuring for a big guy.
You're not breaking the bank. You're not telling, you know, when you make a deposit, you know, they're not inviting you to the back room or nothing like that. You know what I'm saying? Like, come on back here.
You're
going
to have to
that.
Sign extra paperwork.
No. It's just something. And all of a sudden, you make personal decisions like on anything else. This is like, All right, let me put it in layman's term. One of you motherfuckers opens up an iPhone shop. Joey, what's an iPhone shop? You go in, I fix the fucking screen.
You know, buy a case.
I buy the case. I sell charges. Headphones. You know, you don't want insurance, so you come to see me. Mm-hmm. And you know what? I don't do too bad at 45 a pop, plus 62, 50 an hour, whatever they charge you. You know, in the glass. It's like fucking $800, $900 a day in my little fucking place. I pay $1,000 rent, and guess what happens now? Okay. Guess what happens 10 years in? Some motherfucker moves in and does the same shit I do for $10 left down the corner. What do you do, Lee?
You can't lower your price because then he'll lower his price, right?
I mean, what do you do? You live with it. At night, you go home as a business owner. Now, this motherfucker wants to open up now and my kid's going to college. Right. Like, my kid's 2 years away from going to college, and this motherfucker wants to open up now. So what do? You get insecure. You know, you start thinking about lighting the guy's business on fire and doing a bunch of shit, you know, but you don't think about...
Jewish lightning, yeah, I think you call it.
Yeah, Jewish lightning. You don't think about the essential, Thibault. You don't go like, you know what? I needed that because that means I got to bring my game to the forefront. No more coming in here at 9:30. The door says 9. Why are you coming? You know what I'm saying? Like, you yourself catch yourself. We all do. We all do go, you know what, man? I've been fucking slipping lately. What the fuck am I doing buying white bread? Like, the other day, my wife bought white bread. And I caught myself getting, I go, Terry, what happened to the wheat bread? I didn't think you, no, what think? I never said nothing. You the one that told me that they didn't have it at Ralph's, so you got the white bread, now you bought it again. I don't understand when the fucking rules changed. It was wheat bread for the last 8 fucking years.
Well, that's the thing for me, and I actually wanted to ask Thibault, is like, I hate change. Like, I get
everybody does.
I get
everybody
anxiety, does. But I get anxiety about, like, I just finished a TV show. I had to pick a new one. I was like, I was sitting at home wondering today, like, is part of the issue with getting, like, sober that you're scared of, like, changing? Like, absolutely. That change scares
100%, 100%. But I think there's a great saying, which is the pain that you're in has to exceed the fear of change before you take the effort. So until you're in enough pain, you're not going to face the fear, because the fear of change is high. So your pain level is going to be up and down right around there. But the minute that pain exceeds the fear of change, you're not going to do shit till then.
Jeez,
so eventually you wind up in enough pain that you go, fuck it, man. I'd rather face this fear of change than be in this amount of pain this much. Does that make sense, man?
Yeah, absolutely. Like, I had to get to 315 pounds before I started losing weight. That's
crazy. A human condition, man. Yeah. The human condition is like, I'm in enough pain that I'm willing to face this fear of change, which is huge. It's huge, you know? So addicts and alcoholics and people like that always have, our level of that, you know, difference is much bigger than most people.
You'll put yourself through a lot of shit.
Yeah.
For no reason.
You're like, cool, man, I'll be homeless and I'll, you know, do whatever. I'll be homeless and sell drugs and sleep on people's couches before I'm willing to change. Like, normal people make a change much quicker than addicts and alcoholics do. You know what I'm saying?
I saw this great, because of all the rain here in LA, they did this video series, like Fox, with like a couple different homeless people. And like the two or three that they showed were all, like, one was like an engineer before, and one was just a good guy, but his wife died. So, and he couldn't handle it. And I was just like, I couldn't imagine letting some, like, if Paula died or if someone died, I'd get sad, but I couldn't imagine letting your life go to ruins. It's I guess that's the difference with, like, addiction or something.
It's not ruins, it's that, it's a tough thing. What, you know, what's that expression? One man's pizza is another man's turkey or something like that. One man's gumbo.
Trash is treasure.
Yeah, you know. Nobody knows how people are going to handle things.
Pizza and turkey.
Listen, my father died. My friend died. My mom died. And I'll tell you what devastated me the most.
I mean, you've been to the
ringer,
Joe.
Well, yeah, I'll tell you what devastated me the most, the divorce.
Really?
That divorce took 4 years to settle my head in anger.
Really?
And another 5 years to get rid of pain. It was a 9-year thing.
Yeah.
Because I can't imagine how somebody feels when they're in court. And this guy that you, me and you killed together, you and I snorted coke together, you and I fucked the chick together in the ass and dumped her. You know, just a thousand things we did together. And all of a sudden, one day it ends, and you're sitting in court, and you're facing 25 years, and Joe Diaz is looking at you, telling the court everything he said. You know what, man? If I know Jayson Thibault, you think Jayson Thibault gives a fuck about doing time? Right. Jayson Thibault knew the life. He knew that someday...
Jayson Thibault's done time.
He's going to fucking do time. And he's going to, you know, he's moving this. He's shooting people. He's involved in loan sharking or whatever. And now this day has come. Do you know what Thibault's angry about? That his best fucking friend is doing this. You can't recover from that.
Yeah.
Some people cannot recover from that.
From, like, betrayal?
That betrayal, that's what it, is, it yeah. stings. It destroys who the fuck you are. You can't wrap. Listen, people fold when they can't wrap their heads around something. Do you understand me? People fold when you cannot. A lot of things happen to you, but when you can't wrap your hand around it, your head around it.
Mm-hmm.
You know, when I was 16, I could not wrap my head around the fact that there was a God. Once I buried my mother, I was like, don't you ever mention God around me.
Do you believe now?
Yes.
How long did it take?
More than ever. How long more did it than take? Ever.
Same for me.
Whether it's God, a it's Buddha, something. It's a something. Black, a Chinese, a Jew with a machine gun, there's something out there that shows you the love of your work. You know? Yeah. And I'm not getting religious here. I'm not being a whatever. But I see it. Last night, guys, I took a fuck. Last night. I went through a batch of anxiety, so I stopped eating edibles. I was just smoking pot. I was having a great time. And last night I'm typing, I'm trying to write, I'm thinking, I'm drinking coffee, and I look over, there's a picture of whatever, me and Terry, but there's a little thing there, and there's a cookie, a pot cookie that's been in there for like a month. I think it was old. It had
just mold. On your shelf?
It had mold on it. Yeah,
only mold. Joey has like, it was in a wrapper. Moldy. Like okay. A treasure
because I gave it all away. People gave it to sure. me. And I gave it to
And we
to,
do get a lot of stuff right. like
that. Right. So I gave it away and I left this cookie. That was a strong cookie and I cut it and I ate half of it.
A moldy cookie.
A moldy cookie. And I fucking ate half of it.
Monster.
I threw the other half away. And then an hour later I went back and took another bite out of the garbage. You know me. I'm a professional. And then I threw it away. But the point is, like, at 10 o'clock, I was wiped out, and I went to bed. I swear to God, this happened to me, guys. At 3 o'clock in the morning, I didn't even know what time it was.
Yeah.
I just opened my eyes. It was dark. It was fucking freezing. I had the blanket over my head. It's freezing in my room. And the first thing that came to my mind was January 7, 2006. If I would have said, Terry, can I talk to you for a second? And she would have said, yeah. Listen. Here's the deal. I'm going to stop doing blow. I'm going to get my life together. We're going to get married. And we're going to have a baby. Not just a little baby, but a cute little fucking baby. That's a monster. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
There's no way she would have believed that. There's no way. I sat there in bed and giggled. And as we were walking Mercy to school this morning, I go, hey, I got to ask you something. If I would have sat you down January 2006 and told you we were going to get married, I was going to stop doing blow. Not only that, we're going to have a kid. Would you ever fucking believe it? We were both howling. Howling. Like, she's like, are you fucking kidding me? Like, are you fucking kidding me?
Yeah.
All this happened because I stopped doing blow.
Yeah.
Like, there was another world out there. I thought I was living.
That's what people don't get. That's
I thought I was living. I wasn't alive. I was dead because there was a whole other world out there that I wasn't exploring that the coke wouldn't let me explore emotionally. And I think of that line right there. There's got to be a God. You know, I lost my other daughter when she was about 18 months. From 18 months to 5 years, it got worse and worse and worse. I was only seeing her once a week.
Mm-hmm.
And I feel like I'm picking up where I got taken away. Like I'm just picking it up, this up with mercy. This doesn't happen. This doesn't happen to a guy like me. So there has to be something out there that the stars align. I love to tell you that. I'd love to tell you that this happened because I deserved it or not. No. This happened because I suffered. I paid my fucking dues.
Yeah.
I paid my fines. I replaced the karma. I had fucked a lot of people. And I got a fucking a little handout from somebody. Could be. When I die, I don't know who's going to be up there and go, hey, I took care of you. I hope it's a Jew fucking guy that... you know, got fucking like a stabbed in Auschwitz, and he loved me. His spirit fell in love with me, and now he's granting me all these good things. You know what I'm saying?
That'd be great.
You know, I was a guy that did a gram on the way home from the store.
I was no stranger to coke.
And then once I got home, after about 2 o'clock, I waited for John.
We talked about this in the kitchen the other night at the store.
To get off work, and he would bring me another gram of blow. That's 2 grams of blow. That's $120 a night.
That's a lot.
That's four fucking nights, 5 nights a week.
That's two myself, parties of four.
By myself. I did this, and one day I just stopped. Did I stop because I was a genius? Did I stop because I had the answer? I tell you, I wish I could look at people and go, I stopped. I could heal you and get $100 a head for smacking you in the head. Yeah. I stopped because something happened up there. Somebody went like this with their hand and said, give this guy some strength. He can't be doing this anymore. That's it. Something happened. So that's what makes me believe in God. That's what makes me believe in God.
I think a lot
but
of
when
people
I was 16, that... there was no belief. Fuck. No. Listen, take that fucking Jew God of yours and shove him up your mother's ass. There's no God. You might as well, because he took away. How can God take away somebody's mother? Fuck God. Yeah. Fuck God. Who the fuck is, you know what I'm saying? Like, that's your mentality. They break you down. Some people, when you can't wrap your head around something, Lee, it's fucking difficult as fuck.
Yeah. And what, like, what do you mean difficult?
Jesus. Especially when you're not an adult. You're not an adult. Something bad happens to you before the age of 20. It's very easy for you to go, you know what, life is so unfair, like, I'm just going to ride it out and do whatever I want and not have any, like, you know, I don't accept the ramifications of existence, so to speak.
You know what I saw today? There was a Anderson Cooper years ago, I don't even know where I saw it, did a story about these gay guys and, like, the right when AIDS came out or was big and they were having sex to get AIDS. So they wouldn't have to worry about it, or HIV, so they wouldn't have to worry about it anymore. Like, could you imagine just giving up that much? Like, do people OD just so they don't have to worry if I'm going to OD?
I don't know. I mean, I think that's technically called suicide.
Yeah.
But I think people that just, I mean, I can relate to the feeling of going, you know what, man, I'm sick of fighting. Like, I'm just going to, like, I know I shouldn't be doing this, and I'm just going to, like, say, fuck it. I can relate to that a lot. I can relate to, like, you know, it's a temporary solution to a permanent problem, and that's the problem. Like, for me, I can speak about myself. For me, like, I can be like, yeah, man, everything sucks right now. I shouldn't be drinking, but I'm going to get it fucked up tonight, and I'll deal with this shit tomorrow. And then tomorrow's 2 years later because you wake up the next day and you feel like shit, and you have this permanent problem. And I go, well, I know this 12-hour solution. And then it's just 12 hours, you know what I mean? And it's like, then you're... You know, and that's like 38 years old, and then you're fucking 41. And you're like, holy shit. And in LA, every day looks the same, so it's even trippier. You know what I mean? It's 72 degrees. It looks exactly the same. So 3 years can go by. You don't feel even seasons coming through. So all of a sudden, it feels like it's been 4 months that I've been drinking. I've been drinking for 2 years. You know? It's like Groundhog's Day. And it's like, it's just like, I say fuck it today. Tomorrow I'll deal with it, you know? And that's like when you get in recovery, and again, I can only speak for myself, you know, you get this intimidated feeling of like, I can't live my life day to day. I can't just be sober one day at a time. That's stupid. That's what my head says. That's how I drank. You know, I wasn't worried about New Year's Eve on July 9th.
Fuck no.
I just wanted to get fucked up on July 9th.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And I'll worry about July 10th on July 10th.
Tomorrow's
another day. So I'm awesome at doing day to day. That's exactly how I fucking drank. I could get $120 drunk with $7 in my pocket. I can't pay $120 cell bill with $7. This shit is smarter than me, dude. You know what I mean? Like, it is smarter than I am. It can figure out how to get $120 drunk with $7 to my name. Now that I'm clean, I haven't had a drink in, you know, not quite a year, but a little over 11 months. Right now, I am baffled at how to pay $120 cell bill with $7. You know what? If I was addicted to cell bills, I would be hanging out at AT&T. I would know everybody that worked there. All of a sudden, I'm on some weird employee discount. All of a sudden, they're like, hey, man, don't worry. This month's on us, blah, blah, blah. But my addiction is booze. So I know every bartender in fucking Los Angeles. I drank free at the Comedy Store and Improv and Ice House for a fucking decade. I could go there with $3 without a spot and know that I could leave at 2 a.m. train wrecked and come home with $7.
How much fun is that?
It was fun for about five of those 12 years. 7 of those years, it was not fun, Diaz, because I was doing it for the wrong reasons.
Just getting $45, 40 for a gram, and 5 for a bartender tip.
So you
drink all fucking night for free. That's it. Just give them $5 and all night. Just keep bringing glasses, empty fucking glasses, and sipping those things down. It's funny.
I get one draft beer that's $3. I give them a 10, and I'm drinking all night for free.
Draft beers.
Or, you know, then you switch up to something else later.
A couple Jack and Cokes.
Oh, yeah, that was
couple my move. Lemmys and shit.
The only thing I ever, like, romanticize is beer and whiskey. I wasn't a wine guy. I wasn't a tequila guy. I drink anything if you put in front of me. But whiskey and booze and beer was my shit.
And cigarettes.
Yeah, but that's still
fuck yeah.
Still part of the mix. And Coke. The minute, like, in, especially with alcoholics, the minute you find cocaine, your clock starts ticking. Your doomsday clock. Because I could drink 12 drinks, stagger into a bathroom, do a line of Coke, come out sober.
And go right back
to work. And then everyone's like, how is this guy
standing up?
Yeah, exactly.
It sobers you up, really?
I mean, you could be, I don't even want to say, probably a lot of accidents will be happening after I say this, but you could be obliterated drunk, do 2 lines, and probably drive home safe if it's within like 2 miles.
I could drink like a motherfucker. I could drink those Budweiser cans.
Oh, yeah.
Like they were going out of style when I was doing coke. That's how you know I was doing blow. Joey's fucking down in those things. 2 yeah. sips, a can of Budweiser.
Is that what made you put on the weight, you think?
No.
I could always tell you were doing coke because you would always sweat a lot.
I would sweat constantly. Yeah, yeah.
If I saw you not on stage, you didn't even have a spot, you were just coming through to say what's up, and you were sweating like Mike Tyson in a spelling bee, I knew some shit was fucked up.
And I wouldn't even be doing blow, and I'd be sweating on stage. It was so in my system.
Because it's like you're conditioned to associate that with...
I wouldn't do blow till after I got off stage. Once I got off stage, then I would do it. Because I learned early on I couldn't function.
But then your body starts associating blow with a set?
No.
Oh, okay. Like no, I thought you would go on stage and you would like...
I would go on stage. You know, when you do blow 4 nights a week, you're always high.
Yeah.
You're always high.
Because even if it's your day off, you're still cuckoo for Cocoa Puffs.
Still cuckoo for Cocoa Puffs. The next day, I wouldn't get sober till like 6, and then I would just get sober enough. Like, I wouldn't be getting high all day. I wouldn't do anything all day. I'd be smoking pot. I wouldn't drink or anything.
Yeah.
Once I got to the store, I'd get my package, put it in my top pocket. And as long as I went on stage, knowing the packages in my pocket, everything was going to be
you're right. good.
I'm good to go.
Now, what if you had a set where you didn't score yet?
I would still do great.
Okay,
you
know? Okay.
I just was just...
It wouldn't
I,
throw you off.
No. Half the time, somebody didn't have it. And I would go to my other guys. I would go to El Compadre on the way home. 50% of the
that
time...
That was a place for me.
50% of the time, I went down there with nothing with the intention of, I'm not getting nothing down here tonight. I'll just
the
get it
Sunset
El
and
Compadre.
Gower El Compadre or the one all no, the way
the
around?
No, the one in Hollywood. The one in Hollywood and then the one... Well, there was one all the way on the other side.
No, but the Hollywood one.
This is the one over here, right by the Guitar Center. And then I had the Martel Cartel. I had an Armenian guy. I had 4 different dealers. Hmm. So I would, before I left the house, I'd already have the money in my pocket, and I already had the wheels turning. I was going to bump into one of them. And then worst case scenario, Sergio. And I'd bump him for 2. That fucking cut that was terrible.
Yeah.
But it was funny. You were talking. I learned from people, man. I've always been the type of guy to look at people and see how people recover from different things. For a long time, I would meet people, and they'd say, this is my nephew. His name is Tony, and I look at him, and I go, he's 16. I look at the 16-year-old, and I go, could he go through what I went through at 16? And I look at people, and I get sad. I get sad for years. I go,
I can relate to that.
Look at how young that kid is.
No wonder
I'm fucking nuts. Really? But when I was 19, I met this guy, sweetheart of a guy. Guy drank 3 beers and hugged you, but he was in love with this girl. He had been with her. If I was 19, this guy was maybe 22. He drove the bus to pick you up when you went white water rafting at the bottom
of
the river.
He was like a shuttle?
Yeah, he was from Minnesota, and he had a bunch of friends out here, and he had moved to Minnesota with a girl. He had moved to Colorado with a girl, and I would talk to them, and they had been dating since they were 14. Like, they were each other's first,
right?
Whatever. And they went to Colorado, and everything was fine. They lived in an apartment with a bunch of other guys. And, you know, they partied. They were young. I was on the first floor, so I would hear them. And I became friends with all when we played tackle football. And I was in Colorado for the first year. And just before I got to leave, there was a rumor going around that they broke up. And one day I saw him, and I could tell he was a little weird, and I asked him, hey, man, how you doing? He goes, you know, me and Keels broke up. Yeah, I'm so sorry to hear that. And then I heard rumblings that she had started dating a guy in the apartment. So she left
that him. He lived in.
They all, it's like me, you, Lee, grew up together.
Ugh.
It was 13 of them in a three-bedroom house.
Jesus, you know? Christ.
And what they did was they all wanted to ski. When you're 20, you'll do things you know we won't do when you're 30. When you're 20, you go, wait a second, Joey. So if I give you $150 a month, that's my corner right there.
Yeah.
That's how minded. I don't give a fuck. As long as I can put my skis outside and ski and maybe bartend once a week.
I'll take the couch.
I'll take the fucking couch. When you're 20, you do. So this, I went up there a couple times. The place was spotless. But in that apartment, you know, it was like 12 people. Three bedrooms and a living room. And a bed, the one guy had a tent outside. And fucking interesting shit. And they were nice kids and they had parties. But I watched this guy, and he was a daredevil. So in the summer, he drove.
How old are you at this time in your life?
I'm 19.
Okay.
I'm 19.
Oh, you're young.
I'm a dishwasher. Comedy is not on my horizon by no means.
Right.
The only thing that was on my horizon was crime. There was no other thing on my horizon. I used to get drunk and do creepy fucking shit back then. I would get drunk and do a line of coke and burglarize places when I was drunk. It was fucking creepy, but...
It's crazy. I always picture you as older in Colorado.
No, no,
but
no.
You're fucking 19.
He was a kid in Colorado. Yeah.
And all of a sudden, I left. And when I left, I kept in touch with people, and they'd always tell me, did you hear what happened? This motherfucker hid under a car one night. The dude that she cheated on? Like, okay, so...
The guy that's your buddy?
Okay, so my buddy, and... So now there's rumbling. So I leave Colorado, and I keep in touch with this kid Mikey and this kid Jimmy. And every time I talk to him, I say, what's going on with this guy? And they go, dog, we forgot to tell you. He caught her in bed finally one night with the dude. And it was so traumatizing for him that I had to get his number and call him and go, hey, man, how you doing? He's like, you know, he never, and I remember that going, that guy can't wrap his head around this. This is too much for him.
That's pretty crazy. From 14 years old?
From 14. Now they were 21, and they were going to get married and have kids and go back to Minneapolis. And now she leaves him for a guy in the apartment. Not only that, he walks in one night, and she's on top of him, bouncing up and down.
That would make sense.
He packs his bag. He moves out. Okay. He gets an apartment. He's getting eaten alive. One night, she goes to a bar with a bunch of girls, and they all go into different cars. She goes into her car. As she's going into a car, she feels a hand grab her ankle. He was hiding under the car. She put a restraining order, but she put a restraining order on him before this. He wasn't violent or anything, guys. He just wanted to know why. That's it. I remember calling him, and he was crying. And he's like, I wanted to know why. By the time I got back to Colorado, he was drinking 4 or 5 nights a week. And this guy was a good-looking blonde dude that was built.
Mm-hmm.
He could get pussy the next day. He had no problem. Personality, smile, always smiling, cracking jokes, never had a T-shirt on.
But it's the only pussy he ever knew.
Yeah, you know, and now he had to readjust. And guys, I saw this guy's demise. In front of me, that his parents had to come from Minnesota, pick him up, and put him in a mental health in 1987. This went down in 83.
How old was he at the time?
He was 21, and by the time he was 25 or 26,
he was fucked up.
His parents had to come get him and put him like in a fucking psychiatric ward. That always messed with me because he couldn't recover from her pussy, and I get it. I never know what happened to him. You know, I talked to one of the girls, and I said, whatever happened to Big Mike? And they're like, you know what? He went to that place, and he was in there for years, supposedly. And it was all because he wanted to know why. The shock of him seeing that woman bouncing on top. And this girl, I think they put me in a mental health facility, too.
Really?
She was no joke. Yeah, she was really thick. She had black hair, beautiful face.
Big tits.
Just a body and a half. Uh-huh. And she lost it too. She ended up selling blow for a while and some shit went down. But it's amazing how he could not wrap his hands around it. And I saw it. Guys, when I went back in 84, 85, he was 80 pounds heavier, sloppy, body odor, saying weird shit, thinking I'm not joining the fucking service. And he wanted to go over. What was the big war, Beirut?
In what year?
Oh, 86, 87.
Yeah, that's probably Beirut.
He was talking about Beirut, too. Going to Beirut and shooting motherfuckers. I mean, this guy was a peace-loving fucking American. And all of a sudden, one day, 6 months later, I hear, dog,
he doesn't give a fuck.
His mom came and got him and had to take him back with the father in like a jacket strapped, you know, and that's it. And it's how he dealt with it. You know, I think they would have wrapped me in a jacket if I didn't have my friends and the drugs. I don't know. But
what was harder to get through, the drugs or the divorce?
The divorce. The
really? Divorce. More than coke?
Listen, man, when somebody fucking.
More than anything in your life. That was the hardest thing you went through.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes. The divorce destroyed my inside.
Why do you think that is?
Because, listen, I accept as a man, I accept that you're not in love with me no more.
Sure.
I accept that.
What couldn't you accept?
I wasn't in love with her. I couldn't accept her taking a child's love and switching it around. I couldn't accept how...
Lack of control?
Her parents were these people that went to church 7 days a week. They donated to the church. When you went over there, they spoke at the church. They were fucking great people. You know, she was raised in this home that... I would have given my hand to be raised in this home. I was telling Mick Betancourt the other day, Mick, when we were kids, you know, there's people who came from a mom and a dad family with sisters and a dog, and they had the station wagon. And the summers, they went to Florida, and they lived like normal people. Then you had kids like us that were missing a parent.
Same here.
The moms drank. And you know what? You watch the Waltons, and from time to time, you said, you know what? I'd trade my mom in to live with the fucking Waltons to say
you know, when I was younger... You know, my father was a big drinker. Both of my grandparents died from addiction or disease one way or another. I haven't talked to my father in 20-something years. Child molester, used to fight me like a man when I was seven. Like, I saw shit. By the time I was seven, I saw shit most people shouldn't have seen. And then, you know, luckily for me, my mother left my father for a woman. So I was raised by lesbians from, like, early 80s, you know. Still have lesbian, you know, parents. You know, I was 12 going on 34. You know what I mean? I had seen shit. You know, I'd been to more funerals than weddings, even today. You know, I was going to AIDS funerals in the 80s when, like, you know, and I was 12, 13, you know? It's like you grew up in that. And so you, I don't know. I think certain people get to see a little too much at a younger age, you know? And I it sounds like you can relate to that.
I always tell people that I'm jaded. There's parts of me that are very much jaded. And I'm jaded from that early age because, you know, and I know Michael Jackson made this a big thing of his life that he didn't have a childhood. You know what, man? I didn't have a childhood.
Kind of didn't either?
Because I didn't want a childhood. When I was 13, playing fucking Battleship was not what I wanted to do. When I was 10, it was not what I wanted to do.
Agreed.
So I always felt very insecure that I wasn't like the rest of the kids. I've told on this podcast 1,000 times, being 12 or 13, and all these kids in the neighborhood telling me about, man, you got to watch this show, Saturday Night Live, Mr. Bill, Samurai Night Fever. And I went home and watched it and said, this isn't funny. I'm not laughing one fucking time. And I couldn't fucking figure it out. I was thinking about the kids. You even know, you... There's people who live their life trying to be cool.
Sure.
They just, they do everything. They like the music everybody else likes. They like the fucking clothes everybody else likes. I grew up with this kid, Jose Hurtado. His dad sold a ton of blow. My mom owned the building, so my mom rented the apartment to him upstairs.
Yeah.
And I would hear my mom's rumblings about the old man. And because my mom and we were all friends, he would come to all my parties as a child. Mm-hmm. Jose Hurtado was a nice Catholic boy, like a Spanish Catholic boy that was decent. But Jose, when we were...
You guys are the same age?
We're about the same age, maybe a year apart.
Yep.
When we were about 13, one day I saw Jose and he was completely different. He went from being a Cuban kid to a wannabe white kid. With a Rolling Stones t-shirt on, and he always had a beer, and then he got caught robbing a car. You know, by the time I was 17, he already had a resume. Like, people were talking about this guy, and I felt bad for him. I knew something was...
Talking bad about him or good?
No, people were already talking. He was crazy. He was fucking crazy.
Oh, gotcha.
But he was just overreaching. Like, I always knew he was overreaching for these fucking guys. Because he had the same problem everybody else had. I was Spanish, and the fucking 30 kids, I was the only Spanish kid. So you don't know where the fuck your head is at. And he was in the same position, but in a different neighborhood.
Right.
Jose, and I bumped into Jose every 5 or 6 years, and he always had heavy drugs on him. You know, I'd bump into him like coke, the weirdest,
anything heroin, above coke.
Pills, Tumenols, anything that was out there. Sure. And he always had three people, like three fucking idiots with him. And he was always like the lead idiot, like giggling. Yeah. And it was just one of those guys. And about a year ago, one of my friends says to me, "Hey, man, has he friended you?" And I go, "He's fucking alive? Where'd you bump into that fucking
lunatic?" Recently?
Yeah, a year ago. Oh. And he's telling me, "Oh, I bumped into him. He was standing out of pain. He was outside of a pain clinic, like waiting for pills. He's still fucking crazy." So he goes, "He's on Facebook." So about a week ago, I went on Facebook and looked at his thing. He didn't change. Like, it was the same guy from high school. Every picture is him with a beer cup in his hand and a cigarette in the other hand.
That's why I didn't want to be.
With some ugly chick.
That's why I'm afraid of being. That looks like
she sucked 1,000 dicks, missing a tooth. So, you know, I mean, you had to see these, and they're all at like shitty
old men concert. That's why I could have
been. Oh, my God. That was me, too.
Me, too.
He was at a bunch of like old shit concerts. Like, let's say, you know when an old shit band gets together, like and they have a show like in Roswell, New Jersey.
It's like their last reunion ever, but they had one last year and they'll have one next year.
Yeah, he's there with eight guys, and every picture he's got a beer can in his hand, like to show everybody that he's partying.
It's like if you find yourself at a fork in the road, you could either guaranteed you're going to be that guy, or I guarantee you have no idea who the other guy is going to be. And that's the fear that we talk about earlier, which is the pain of becoming that guy greater than the fear of the unknown? And that's the fork in the road, man. Take that left turn. Don't become that dude, you know?
Were all of his friends the same high school friends?
No, he hung out with these creepy people.
They're all probably younger than him.
All those people like that scared me. Like, I used to live downtown. At one point, I stopped hanging out with downtown people. Because they would sit together in a circle, listen to music, smoke cigarettes, and they all developed the same goofy laugh.
Downtown LA or downtown Denver?
Downtown in Jersey.
Well, Jersey back in the day, yeah.
And they would blow smoke out of their mouth and laugh. And they all would do it the same. And they'd go like, and they listen to "The Boys Are Back in Town" by Thin Lizzy. And my blood pressure would go up 60 over a fucking 1,000 because I hated that song. These losers couldn't pick up the fucking flu. And they're sitting around.
I hate
around.
That song too.
Oh my God. It was like an anthem for these goofballs.
When you hear it, does it give you chills?
When I hear it, I listen to the first verse just to get pissed off.
Really?
Like if I'm in the car, guess who's back in town today? The wide-eyed boy. Oh, you motherfucker. And I'm always on the 170. Like I'm always going from the 101 to the 170.
Why do you hate it so much?
That song, because it's like an anthem for knuckleheads.
Because it's like an earmark of a book. Like
it's like an anthem for the boys are back in town. You ever hang out with guys like that? The boys. What the fuck do you do that you're the fucking boys? The boys are back in town. Where were you? In prison? Where'd you come back from? The fucking home? The tunnel?
When I see guys that love that song, I automatically feel bad. I automatically feel bad for their significant
other. It drives me fucking crazy. It drives me fucking crazy.
I feel bad for their girlfriends because they're just like at home, just like waiting for a black eye.
Is it like the guys who like go to Vegas? See, like... Go to club in Vegas?
No, it's a certain breed.
More the dog track.
It's four guys that get dressed up, and like two of them really have nothing going on. But trust me, I was part of that crew for years.
It's like strip club during the day.
And the boys were not back in town, okay? The boys were not back in town.
They never left town.
From 83 to 85, I would go in and out of North Bergen. I thought it was cool to go in and out of North Bergen.
What's North Bergen?
North Bergen is where I grew up.
Okay.
And I would go in and out of North Bergen. I'd go to California for a month and come back. I would go to Miami for 3 weeks and come back with a pound of blow. I would do different things.
Pound of
and
blow?
In the back of my mind, like, at that time, I didn't think about it. But I felt like I was trying, I don't know. I was like trying to create a, and I wasn't. I just didn't fucking like living there. People were always looking for me. I was always in trouble, so I always had to like burn somebody, leave for a while, and then come back.
In trouble like you owed people money?
Money, or we robbed something, and the word out that it was us. just fucking craziness. You know, you look at people who you don't want to become. Right, like
that's part of it. That's a huge part of change.
It's like when you go to
you're intimidated to hang out with people that have something that you want because you don't think you're good enough and you don't belong in that circle. So you continuously, like I was always more content being the guy hanging out with a bunch of dumb fucks who I was like, well, at least I'm not as bad as this guy, you know. But then slowly you become that guy that everybody else. Slowly you be like my biggest fear. I was like. I don't want to be the fucking 50-year-old at a Coke party with a bunch of 28-year-olds. Remember how much when you were 28, you hated that fucking guy?
We were just saying it.
But you had to hang out with him because he had the fucking Coke. I was slowly becoming that guy, and then I became that guy where I'm the guy, you know, with a bunch of 24-year-olds, and I got a fucking 8-ball, and I'm hanging out with these people just because they'll hang out with me because I got a fucking 8-ball. But I know they're talking shit about me behind my back because I used to talk shit about that guy behind his back.
When I was 22 and I go to a bar, I feel old, number one.
That's crazy. Always, that's already crazy.
There's always four or five guys that are in their 40s.
Yeah.
And I look at them and go, what the fuck are these fucking losers doing in here?
Yep.
Why are they fucking here?
Yeah.
When I'm that age, I wouldn't. It's like when I go to a weed store and I see a guy my age with a ponytail and like a Led Zeppelin shirt on.
Right.
And he's still talking about
Grateful Dead
or something. I want to shoot myself in the fucking leg. I really do. I'm like, what the fuck are you thinking, guy? Go get him. Go mend a sweater. Go play shuffleboard. Anything's better than still talking about this shit and wearing it on your shirt. It's fucking embarrassing. Like, I'll tell you what people drove me crazy the most. When I got locked up, there are cliques of people that sit together every day and talk about the prisons they've been to. Lee, you have to see this.
In prison, there are people that are prison elitists.
Elitists. And other people look up
to them. I've been to San Quentin, dog. You don't even know nothing about San
Quentin.
Fuck
San Quentin. I've been to Sing Sing.
Shit. I've been to Sing Sing, C Block. And all of a sudden the guy's like, yeah, I know this guy. And it's hysterical. When they're like, yeah, I know Lee up in C Block. You know Lee Syatt? Yeah.
They name drop. There's name drop.
Yeah, I party with that fool. I party with him a couple times too. Right. The guy up there, One-Eyed Louie, he used to get his heroin. We'd sell the cotton balls, and you're sitting there, and they're telling about the jails they've been to. It's like that scene in The Longest Yard in the beginning where they go, where are you from? Kansas State. They got nice mattresses there. Like, people actually say that. Oh, my God, the pancakes at the correctional facility in Illinois are to die for. The chocolate
that makes
chip.
Sense.
The chocolate chip ones, yeah. Like, you want to actually commit a crime in that thing to fucking eat the chocolate chips.
Yeah, yeah.
It's fucking crazy, Lee. When guys would sit around and brag about the different prisons they were at and talk about the guys they knew, like they were like fucking PhDs. Wait, you're talking about a guy that murdered three people. Like, right. He's like this great philosopher. Are you fucking crazy? Are you fucking retarded? Are you fucking crazy? And then they show up, he's here. There was like, where I was at, there was maybe 200 fucking losers and maybe 8 people who had a chance. I'm telling you this, I would look at them and go, this guy will be back in jail in a month.
Yeah.
You could just tell, like, they did not have a chance. They had no way they would cope with society.
Did you ever drink toilet wine? You always hear about that.
No, I did meth in fucking prison. I did fucking
now, as a coke guy, what were your like opinions or thoughts on meth? Like, because you're a coke guy.
I was a coke guy when I got locked up. But once I got locked up, I was done. I was like, I ain't doing no drugs in this motherfucker. I'm not doing no drugs. I went to the county jail. People were getting high in there, doing heroin, coke, smoking weed. I didn't do nothing. I went to diagnostic, and diagnostic drugs were everywhere. It was crazy.
What does diagnostic mean?
Diagnostic is where you go and they look into your brain. They tell you that you're fucking a thief, or they take your blood. They stick a finger up your ass. They make you cough. They fucking do x-rays on everything. They take your fingerprints. They take psychological tests, math tests. You take every test that can be thrown at you. That all goes to the feds. The feds have everything on you now. How smart you are in algebra, if you can read and write. And then they put you through a point system. Do you have a high school diploma? Were you working at the time of your arrest? Were you renting? Were you owning? All those things are point systems when you go through the system.
Okay.
So I was doing great. And all of a sudden, they sent me to the camp. And once you get to the camp, that's where you start hearing rumblings. There was a lot of drugs. Nobody was smoking weed because they drug test you. So you had to do shit that went through your body quick.
Okay. So a lot of guys, weed like two, 3 weeks will stick in your system. Yeah.
A lot of guys did heroin. Acid you could do because they had to have a test for acid and speed. They didn't get speed yet. It was coke, heroin, pills, and marijuana and alcohol. They didn't really, the speed guys knew that if they drank water, there was something.
Right.
So I'm in there 2 months maybe, and the librarian was a nerdy guy that killed his wife and her husband for cheating on him.
Librarian was an inmate.
An inmate. Okay. Librarian, yeah. Dude. Gotcha. Small dude, yep. From Buffalo. And one night he told me, you want to get high on acid? And we got some acid. We traded with somebody because I had the storage facility.
Like liquid or tabs?
It was tabs. Yeah, it was like blotter. So sure, me and him stayed up all night outside the library and told stories.
What are you talking about?
And the guards were walking by and like, you guys, because I never stayed up. You were supposed to be in your unit, but you could watch TV in there all fucking night. You know what I'm saying? Like, they didn't give a fuck what you did all night. It was lights out.
Okay.
But what was in your TV in your room?
Right.
You could stay up all night reading. Nobody else saw the light in your room, only from the outside.
Okay.
And once in a while, guys got up and they hung in the front of the unit to smoke. So the library was right across from the unit I was stationed. So I would go over and sit on the stairs with him, and he would smoke, and we'd talk shit. Right. I didn't smoke then.
What was it like to do acid in prison? Like, did you freak out?
No, not at all. We just giggled and told stories.
You done acid a lot, though.
By that time, yeah, but I hadn't done it. I wasn't an acid. I stopped doing acid in 86 in San
Francisco. You can't get addicted to that.
The last time I'd done acid was 85 in San Francisco. Everything after that was just straight cocaine and whatever pills I could get my hands on. So it was 87, 88, and we did a hit of acid, and that was it. But then I met this guy, John Clark. John Clark was a white dude. John Clark used to gamble. So he'd always talk to me about gambling. And I knew that the black dudes were scared of him. And a lot of the biker white dudes were scared of him. He wasn't affiliated with nobody. He had tats and shit. But he was from the East Coast. He was a real Philly guy. And I would, like, he had been in jail for so fucking long. I would
talk. For what? For what?
Like murder and like fucking assault. And he was just a badass. So people knew who this guy was. So this guy used to just talk to me. He'd come in the kitchen and talk to me. Like, he had a job picking up garbage or something.
Right.
And that's how he was getting the drugs into the prison. So in the mornings, he'd come talk to me about the Sixers or the... He was a real sports fan, but he liked my accent. He used to tell me, dog, talking to you takes me home, because then I call my father. You make me sentimental when I talk to you, dog. So he started... And then one day he would tell me, nah, when my girlfriend comes on Sundays, she brings the speed. I shit it out Monday morning.
Oh, my God.
And then I snort it Monday and Tuesday. But Mondays, we went to a gym to play basketball. So this went on for a while. For like 2 months, I was friends with John. And we exchanged food. He put bets in with me. He bet the cards. He loved gambling. And he was just a degenerate gambler. He 50 cents a card. He'd bet 10 cards, 20 cards. He'd buy a card. And he could still lose. That's how bad of a loser this guy was. But we became friends, man. He was a solid dude. And one day I go over there, he's like, come here for the thing, you want to do a line of speed? I'm like, fuck yeah. I'm not going to turn this motherfucker. People would die to hang out with this guy. And here I am talking to him like, and I knew he hated spicks and niggas.
Yeah.
It was one of those things, like he was one of those KKK motherfuckers. But dog, he worked his hand when it came to me. He even told me. He goes, by my fucking rules, I can't be hanging out with Cubans, but you're the bomb diggity. Like, I was friends with a dude who ran a kitchen. And you couldn't get to this guy. This guy was an old Italian mobster. People would die. He had his own customers. And John used to say, dog, I heard the guy cooks, but he won't even talk to me. I said, I'll get your food from now on. So whenever the guy made nachos or chili con carne or whatever, I'd get John hooked up. John loved me. So on Monday, John would go, come on over. Let's do a line of speed. Dog, one night I went with him to play basketball. That was a complete different experience. I forgot all about that shit, that you can't run on speed.
What happened?
Is that true?
Oh, my God. You know, what do you think happens? You're already at 135 beats per minute.
You're
going to
have a fucking heart attack.
I'm out there running. Right. All of a sudden, I realize there's not enough
oxygen.
You're
already running on speed.
Yeah, you're already running on speed. Yeah. I would jump up and
you're in the middle of a marathon.
Here I am in prison playing hoops on fucking speed with John Clark on Monday fucking nights.
So you think you're going to die?
I thought I was going to die, but I never played hoops again. But I would stay up all night Tuesday on the fucking speed, go to work Tuesday morning, and then like in the afternoon take a nap, and I was fine.
Back in the day when...
88, this was speed. It was still speed. It wasn't meth yet.
Back in the day before pot was legal, when everyone still had a guy, you had a guy. You'd go there, you'd buy a fucking, you know, you'd buy a gram, you know, or, you know, you'd buy an ounce. And then you'd had seven guys going in on an eighth, and then you would get your eighth for free. Remember that old fucking scam? Fuck, you know what I mean? Yeah, of course. Classic, classic.
And I'd spray it with a spray bottle to make the water go in there so the weed would get heavy.
Yeah.
And I would spray Tebow's double. So by the time he got home, the fucking weed would disintegrate. He'd wake up in the morning, but when he went to bed, there was this much weed. When he woke up, there was this much weed. What the fuck happened to my weed?
You know, and you pinch a little bud from each of the seven, so your eighth was heavy, but whatever. Back in the day, so I would go to this guy, and this guy he was like a drug dealer for every, you know, he had everything. You go there, there'd be dudes that were cleaning like M16s, two dudes cleaning M16s. You would go there, you know what I mean? You're like, oh shit. He's like, yeah, man, this my buddy just paid me with these two guns for like, you know, half a pound of coke. You know, he always had some other shit going on, but he was my weed dealer. So I used to get coke from him. I used to get Valium from him back in the day. And he used to sell coke and Valium at the same time. Like, you can get like if you got like an 8-ball, he'll give you 4 Valium also. Like, weird shit, you know. Shit you shouldn't be taking together. But I remember going there, he goes, you know, I got like I got like an ounce of weed. And he's like, you want to do a line? And you see a line cut up on him. I thought it was blow. I'm like, yeah, man, I'll do a line of coke and then go home and I'm good. Do it. And I'm like, oh, shit. About 2.5 hours later, I found out it was meth. It's the only time I've ever done it. Man, it was like doing 30 lines of coke. I was high for 6.5 hours from one line of this shit. Like, coke you're used to doing. You could do it. You can get off. You can do a couple lines and you can go. You can tap out. You can tap out when you're doing coke. I did one line of this shit because I thought it was coke. That's the only time I've ever fucked that shit. But I was like, oh yeah, I could see people getting fucking dicey on that shit.
I did it one time in West Virginia. I followed some dudes to a cabin.
Did you know that's what it was?
No. I asked them. They were in the bathroom snorting it. And I said, hey, can you get them? They go, no, we don't have none on us. But if you want to follow us, we drove fucking 45 minutes to a trailer. And I'm like, this ain't right. I get the guy like $50. It comes out with like a lump. And I go, this ain't coke. He goes, nah, this is speed. I still did it. You know me. We drove an hour. I'm doing it. One time I did it in Idaho. They put you up. The Funny Bone in Idaho used to put you up in this old-fashioned hotel. And it would creak. The floors would creak. Oh, Jesus Christ.
Like old wood.
I did a lot. But they had showtime, so I could jerk off all night on the speed. And then one night, somebody gave me the bottom of a bag at a Comedy Store. And I did the line, and it was speed. And it set me off, dog. I ended up doing like 15 grams of fucking blow that night.
Really?
I went off deep. I used to go deep.
It's like days. What's the longest run you've had?
The worst run I ever had in my cocaine career. Started on a Friday night. It
was 3 days for me.
And it went till Monday morning. And I dumped... maybe 20 grams. I called the cops twice on myself. I didn't let the dog out to piss.
Did the cops come?
The cops came.
What did they say to you? What did they say to you the second time?
The first time, I told them there was a burglar, and they went around the property and looked. And the second time, they said, can we talk to you for a second? And I go, yeah. And they go, when was the last time you got sleep? How much coke have you done?
Really?
Yeah, and I go.
Was it the same cops?
Yeah.
Yeah, of course.
Yeah. No, it was him and a different one. And I owned one of them.
Like, he switched partners.
One of the guys.
He's been high so long, they switched partners.
Let me tell you how fucking high I was. No. Let me tell you how goofy I was that night. I started on a Friday. I called the cops Saturday, and I called them again.
Monday.
Sunday night.
Okay.
Sunday afternoon. It was daylight out.
Okay.
At that time, I had the coke inside the sink. Where you put the disposal, where you could pop it.
In
case the cops came, I would put the thing up, and I would take little rocks and crawl, and I had on a...
It's a good hiding spot, actually.
Oh, my God. I had a porno... No, I did not have a porno movie. I had one of those freaking movies that somebody shows their pussy, and I would whack off to that. It was just a horrible, disgusting drug weekend. But no, it didn't end there, guys. I called the cops Saturday at, like, 11. Then I called the cops again Sunday. And that's when the one cop came in. And he goes, you really got to get your life together. You know, you can't keep calling the cops on yourself and shit. What did I do? I got a 6 hours sleep, and I walked to the police station the next morning. Still, because just because you don't have coke and just because you slept 6 hours.
Doesn't mean you're not fucked up. That electric is
still in your mind.
Yeah, man.
Just making you make bad decisions. What did I do? I walked to the police station and said there was a burglar because I finally walked around because I was a house sitter. Okay, and I had this big...
So it wasn't even your place.
No, but they had an extension to the garage. When my girlfriend was there, I did coke in the house.
Right.
But since I was alone that night, I did it in my apartment over the garage.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay, he did a caretaker. But that night, I called the cops on myself twice.
How far away was the police station that you walked to?
3 blocks. Walked in and said, I'm sorry about the other night. And the cop's like, what were you thinking? But one of the cops at that time... He tapped on to me. He knew I was crazy. He was crazy. You know, we were talking about dirty cops this week. This is one of my experiences with a dirty cop.
Dirty in what sense?
He got high. I sold him coke on a few occasions. And then he came to me and then he goes, hey, listen, I know that you don't like guns.
Yes.
What if?
Dirty. Definitely dirty
I
cop.
I could give you guns that we have no history on and you could sell them.
No way.
Oh, fuck yeah. So he was just pulling people over and clipping their guns.
Dog. What year is this?
87.
Okay.
What percentage did he take?
Of what?
The guns.
He would show up in my house once every 3 weeks with 4 or 5 fucking guns. Brand new fucking
Berettas. How would you split the money?
I would trade him coke. So he would tell me, what do you want? What do you want for a $500?
So he's paying for coke with guns.
Give me 3 grand. Give me 3 grams of coke. I'd give him 3 grams. You know, he'd come to my house and leave a half ounce of coke, and I'd take 4 or 5 guns from him.
Wow, fuck.
This is a complete, and then this is crazy. I was flat broke, guys. I was flat fucking broke, okay? And I went, and my friends came out to visit me, and we were talking shit, and at that time in Aspen, cocaine was 1,800 an ounce. My friends came out and said, we're getting it for $8. And if you buy 10 ounces, we'll give it to you for $6.50, and it's 90% right off a fucking rock. But you have to take a plane. So $1,800 they wanted for fucking 28 grams.
So for a $200 plane ticket, you make $600.
For a $200 plane ticket, I'm paying $6.50. I'm making fucking
$1,200.
I'm making $1,200 fucking dollars per ounce, and I'm not even. Shit. And that's without cut, guys.
And that's not in 2015, 16.
This is 1986. I'm sitting.
So that's like $3,000, basically.
I'm making $600-$700. I got no reason to lie to nobody. I'm making $600-$700 a week in a video store. I'm stealing two. Okay? I'm making, you know, I'm selling a half gram here. I shared an apartment with a girl. We ate out every night until, you know, we started cooking. We realized we couldn't fucking eat out no more. That's how I'm experiencing all this shit when I talk there. We used to eat out every night and go to dinner, and then we cut that shit out. And one day these guys come out to visit me. I'm clean and sober, guys. I'm clean and sober a year and a half. Wow. And they come out and I start pounding. These are my friends from Jersey. And they're telling me that they fucking got motorcycles and trucks. And the one guy had 8 trucks. And wow. Here I am in a video store making $800. So I go, wait a second. So if I go back there and I pick up, let's pretend, 9 ounces, which is a quarter key. If I pick, and in those days, the guy was like, he just put his
What was a key back then?
It was 30, it was, I think, what's a kilo? 34 ounces. So a key in those days, I don't remember. It was dirt cheap. It was by that time, it was before Reagan sent the troops to Colombia.
Yeah.
So they were stuck. They had so much cocaine. Everywhere else in the country was fucking cheap. But in Aspen, it had this high price tag on it. So, guys, I had no fucking money. So I went, I knocked on Lee Syatt's door. Lee, I know you a long time. Yeah, let me talk to you about something, Lee. You told me once your grandmother left you some stocks and some bonds. And you also told me that some lady died and left you some money. I'm not looking for a loan. This is what I'm looking to do.
You want to make some money?
Give me $5,000 at 8 o'clock. Tuesday night, and by Wednesday night at 8 o'clock, I will give you back $6,500 and 3.5 grams of fucking the same coke I'm getting. That was the deal I was cutting people. So I'd go to 3 or 4 or 5 people, put whatever package I need together, $9,800 or something. I forget what it was. I forget the numbers. I know that I had to take like $10,000. And I would go, and I would already have customers lined up. I'd already go to Lee and go, Lee, come here for a second. What are you paying for now? I'm paying $1,800. What if?
Yeah.
Tonight, I'll give you the ounce of the best coke you got for $1,350. Okay. Cash. Okay. And on the plane, on the way back, coming from Aspen to the guy's hotel room, I'd be fucking cutting the coke with 3.5 grams. I'd take an 8-ball out. Bop. And dog, at the end, you know how much money? I used to sell it before it landed. I would sell it before it landed. Sometimes I get a down payment from a motherfucker. Lee, listen, you want 2 ounces, right?
And a 20% loan in 24 hours.
And that's what I would do.
25% loan in 24
hours. I just knew how to make people money, so I would just keep contacting people. Oh, you want to do it again? Yeah, fuck yeah. What if I told you can make $500 a fucking week off me, Lee? Every fucking week just lending me money and free cocaine. Are you fucking kidding me?
You would do it every week?
Every week I was flying back on United Airlines.
Could you imagine doing that now? You'd probably like set off an alarm. You'd probably like get, like they'd probably be like, why is he
doing that? Oh, he got nine German Shepherds in his back pocket.
Yeah, but the whole thing is, look at now, I do comedy. If I was a greedy, dumb fuck on Thursdays, yeah. I would take an extra suitcase on first class filled with Chiba Chews or Stars of Debt. I would pack them up if I was a greedy, dumb fuck and I had no respect for comedy or my family.
And sell them for like $20 a piece?
I would make a killing.
Did you watch Narcos?
Yeah.
Loved it?
Yeah, I'd have Tebow in New York with a menu. Like Chiba Chews, I get them here for $22. They're paying $30 in New York.
Yeah. Minimum.
And then, but see, a guy like me, I'm a Cuban Jew. I contact Chiba Chew and say, dog, what can we do? I didn't tell him what I'm doing. I'm just telling him I'm going to move volume for you.
Yeah.
I'm going to move. What do you need to move? 22 boxes. What can you do? Well, I'll give them to you for $16.50. That's a different party now.
You save $3 a box, but you're moving that many boxes.
Sure.
Like, fuck, man.
People in the East Coast will buy those by the fucking box. This weed we smoked tonight. This death weed we smoked tonight.
Right.
What are you kidding me? These fucking Stars of Death that my main man gave us. These fucking Star One. These things. It's three for $25, these 200
milligrams. Yeah, they're expensive. Okay? Edibles are expensive.
They're fucking expensive. You could triple your money in New York and people will pay it.
How much a pot is in one, like, one of those?
200 milligrams per star. These are special for Lee. They're like 52 milligrams.
No, I heard they're like 20.
They don't do nothing to nobody. No, it's really fucking weird how that's how I made a living. So every week, but to get to the point of the story, there was this one guy that kept lending me money. He was all in, this fucking guy. This guy.
How did he have his money?
He was, I think his dad gave him money, and he was a wannabe mobster from Detroit. And his sister was married to a dude who owned the pizza parlor. He was a jack-off and a half.
This wasn't the guy you sold the Mafia membership
to,
was it?
No, it was one of his friends. I sold the Mafia membership to in Snowmass.
What does that mean?
This kid can't bother me. Hey, do you know anybody in the mob? Do you know anybody in the mob?
What does that even mean?
Listen to me.
Like, could you ask somebody that? And not even a legitimate question.
Well, this is how retarded he was. He kept asking me, "How do you know anybody who get me in the mob?"
Okay.
I went to like a fucking store and I got like an application. Dog, Tebow, you have no fuck. I was doing it as a goof. I thought he was actually going to look at me.
Is he young?
He was my age at the time. And he had watched every Mafia movie from 1920 on. He was a white kid, and he kept bugging me. I told him to fill it out and put his name and number, relatives. The kid put everything down, Social Security. It was fucking crazy. And this is all, I'm doing this on my own. This is all
fun.
This is all the mind of Joey Diaz.
Yeah.
When this kid showed up with $2,000, I thought this was like a set. I kept going home at night going, I'm going to go to fucking jail. This went on for like 6 months. Every time I'd see him, he goes, dog, nobody contacted me. Are you fucking crazy? I just talked to Louis from the Bronx.
He said, still would bite.
He said they're going to send you a plane ticket so you could do the whole finger, the ceremony. This kid, it was fucking crazy. But this wasn't the kid. This was a kid that I never found out about this till later on. So when I was going downhill, I went to him for a big amount. I already had a hook at him, so now I'm going to burn him. Mm-hmm. So I said, listen, we're going deep.
Right.
We're going to buy 15 kilos. I need like
fucking. You knew he'd go off the diving board with you?
I knew he'd go off the diving board.
Yeah.
And I took the money from those guys like on a Tuesday, and I snorted all the coke. There was no trip. I just hid. Like I used to disappear for 24 hours with the money and come back that Wednesday. That fucking Tuesday, I went.
Yeah.
And because by that time I wasn't really flying back anymore. I got lazy. I was getting too high. I would get paranoid and not get on planes and shit.
Yeah.
So I was just buying it locally, but I still had my customers. I was just cutting the coke and telling the people, you can't sell it to me for 18. You got to take it down to like 14. I'll sell a bunch of it for you. Yeah. So finally I got into such a deep hole. And it was the week of Thanksgiving, 1986. Guys, I had been on a fucking two-month run. This girl I was living with, who turned out having Jackie, her mother, wasn't even basically talking to me. All I was doing was going home, giving her money and giving her coke and leaving. I was going to Cato's house. I had a couple of other broads. I had a room in a hotel. A guy that ran security gave me a room at the hotel for me to put a scale and coke in there.
That's the shit that I mean of like,
oh my God.
I can get $120 drunk on $7.
It was like, all
if you're in
to
that
me.
World and that world is your priority, you get these weird hookups that most people don't understand unless you fucking have been an addict one way or another.
And I would give him coke, and he worked security, so he would stay up all night, and he would watch the hotel, and I'd go into that room by myself and jerk off and fucking take showers and whack off in the shower and crawl and hide, and it was horrible. And then I would go back to this apartment with this poor girl, and one Tuesday, they gave me like, I fucking have no idea, guys. I must have I usually came up with like 15 grand. This time, I came up with like 30 grand cash. And guys, I paid off like $15,000 that I owed, and I bought like $5,000 worth of coke, and I held on to 10. And I fucking went to a friend's house.
That's another level shit.
This was another shit I used to do. I would go to Lee Syatt's house with Paula there and go, can I talk to you? And you come out and go, what's up, Joey? Here's $300. Do me a favor. Get the fuck out of here. Take your fucking girlfriend with you. $300? Really? Yeah. Go get a hotel room for $50. Come on, yeah, get the fuck, let me get your apartment. I was so paranoid to get high in my own house or even hotel rooms. I would go to my friends and go, how about I give you $300? Just let me use your apartment for tonight. What are you going to do? Nothing. I'm going to drink, smoke pot, and jerk off on your couch by myself. That's how fucking bad the addiction was.
Yeah, I can relate to that.
I made plans for Thanksgiving because Thanksgiving was that Thursday. I was supposed to pick up a turkey. I was supposed to have a party at my house. I had 10 people coming over to my house. I was supposed to go to New York and pick up a big fucking shipment of coke. I said, fuck it. I just paid off the debts I had in Colorado, picked up $5,000, snorted it. I walked in that door Thanksgiving about 6 o'clock at night. That poor chick was just sitting there going, what happened? I was at my friend's house for 2 days. I gave him like 2 days' money to just disappear, go to a fucking hotel.
Ugh.
I stayed in his apartment. Some chick came over. God knows what happened. The next day, I had fucking people calling my house all fucking day. The day after Thanksgiving, that phone didn't fucking stop.
What did you think was going to happen?
Oh, dog, it was over. The cops were watching me.
And he's tapped.
I owed three or four drug dealers $10,000 or more.
Yep.
I owed now.
Probably a landlord.
Oh, my God. No, the landlord was free rent. That was house
sitting. Oh, that's right.
I owed the money I was borrowing.
Yep.
I had borrowed from fucking everybody at this point. I was deep. And this kid started getting suspicious.
Right.
So he's knocking on
who me. You're milking? You're milking this cow.
I'm milking this cow.
Yeah.
But I still need coke to leave town.
To make money.
I'm leaving fucking town.
Yeah.
But I got to get coke for the ride to Denver. We had the car in the garage. We had it all packed, and we were going to leave in the middle of the night from Aspen to Denver. There was a house across from us watching us.
Jesus. What do you mean watching you?
There was a guy in there that was watching us from Aspen Police Department. I was selling coke to a guy that cut a deal with the police to bring him dealers because his wife was an accountant for the city of Aspen, and she got caught writing checks for coke. So when they caught her, she goes, how about we cut a deal? I get your drug dealers. So his job was to go out and buy coke. Every time he'd come to my house, he'd go, let me talk to you outside. Wait, why don't talk to me outside for a talk? Because they were up there. So one day I had a friend of mine go through, because snowmass, you go in through the back. So I had him go through the back. And right away he flew over and he goes, dog, you're right. There's guys up there and they have a telescope and they're looking down.
No shit.
So my friend called him. We went downstairs. In those days, when you went to your phone panel, there would be a wire that would have the wiretap order. So if you could break into your phone panel and find your line, you would see the wiretap fucking order. Boom.
Oh.
Once I saw that, I knew I had to leave town. Not only did I owe 80 fucking grand, not only were the cops watching me, I had to fucking go. I was hooked on blow. I had bought this fucking weed that was beautiful. I had a pound of this weed that was beautiful.
Of course you did. Of course you had a pound.
But it didn't get you high.
What do you mean?
I got beat on it. Like, they sold me 2 pounds, and the 1 pound got you high, and the other one didn't.
Gotcha.
Like, the other one was just a Fugazi pound of weed that I had in the dresser. And I knew that my coke dealer liked good weed. So I packed my car, and I snuck over to a house, like, 8 o'clock, and I said, listen, her name is Neely. I go, Neely, I got to talk to you about something. She's like, oh, if you're going to come in here, you better give me some money. I go, I got 1,000 cash, and I got this pound of weed. Right. But you got to do me a favor. And she smelt, and she's like, where'd you get this? This is tremendous. I go, I got this, bitch. I go, I need a half
ounce. It was also late 80s.
I go, I need a half ounce of blow, and I'll bring you back the money in an hour. Meanwhile, I got the money to give her. It was like a last resort.
But you need it.
I needed blow to get out of town.
Yeah.
I needed blow to fucking get out of town.
Why?
Because I needed fucking blow. I wanted to get high.
Yeah, he needs his money.
I need my money.
To live on, but he needs the blow because he's addicted to blow.
You couldn't get it in Denver?
Well, I'm not driving for it. He's on his way out. Blow.
He's on his way out.
I need something to go.
He's like, I'm leaving town. I have the money for blow, but front me some blow, and I'll pay you later. And he ain't paying
and
later.
Here's this pound of weed I'm leaving you. Yeah.
So wait, is that why you didn't get on planes? Because you were...
No! We had a car! What were we going to do, leave the fucking car there?
No. Your anxiety getting on planes, was it because you couldn't do coke for that long?
What are you, a psychiatrist? I don't know. This is 1987. There was no fucking planes. There was planes going to New Jersey and back.
No,
it was just anxiety. I was doing 1,000 fucking things in my head. And I finally couldn't get on planes no more because I knew the cops were watching me. So yeah. I just stopped flying. So now I'm in a fucking bind. I'm leaving town, but you need a package to go. You can't just go with no package dry. Yep. So on the way out, let me rob everybody. I'm leaving, so what difference does it make? So I brought her a pound of weed as collateral, and I said, give me $1,500 worth of fucking blow, and I'll be back in an hour and I'll take the weed back. Plus, here's a grand that I owe you. I owed her like 10 grand at this time. I gave her 1,000, so they're happy. They're like, at least your man. I go, when I make the fucking half ounce of 500 I'll make, I'll give you that too. She gave me the half ounce. I got in my car. I shot out of there. Snorting coke the whole fucking way to Denver. We get to fucking Denver, Lee. Let me tell you how bad my paranoia was. You know how many hotels I checked in and out of?
6.
4. Yeah. 4. I went into a hotel, would go in, do a line.
I thought they were checking on you.
And tell my girlfriend, come on, we got to go. And we'd go across the street like fucking retards, pay another $44, stay in there for an hour. Get the fuck out of there. You have no idea what a dick
is. What did your girlfriend say?
She thought I was crazy, but she was just... She did.
But you went for the ride. You went for the ride.
Remember when that scene in Goodfellas when he comes out and he goes, wait, when he gets out, what's the first thing he says? Where's the stuff?
Yeah, where's the
stuff? And she goes, I threw it out. What do you mean you threw it out?
Pissed, yeah.
The cops were everywhere. No.
He's been thinking about this shit more than her.
That scene was all about addiction. When she got on her hands and knees and she's crying. That's what crazy people do. That's how me and that girl were acting.
And me too.
Me and that girl were acting that way. Like crying and falling asleep.
I always say this, Joe. I always say this. Like, and especially now since I've like, you know, I saw addiction specialist for 6 months. I went to rehab, you know, all the things I've done in the last 11 months. And I've thusly realized I have a preference of the kind of chick I would like to date. So does my disease. So I've dated several times for multiple years women that would probably kill me, but my disease is in love with her because she's not busting my balls. She gets up at 11 in the morning and I'm sitting there still wearing the same clothes from last night, having to fuck another fucking tall boy PBR where I got a line of coke in front of me. And she's just like, cool, finish that. Let's go get some fucking Bloody Marys at 11 a.m. That's the kind of chick that my disease wants me to date. The flip side of that is true. The type of chick I should be with is, you know, like a Terry type where it's like, she comes out, it's 11 a.m., I got a line in front of me, and I'm drinking a tall boy. She's like, the fuck is wrong with you, man? What is wrong with you? Like, what are you doing? You know, I've broken up with her so many times because my disease's vote was higher. 51% or more. You know? And then the flip side of that is true, where it's like, there's been times where I'm like, I've dated girls for 3 years where the cops would come twice a week. I'm like, you guys are fucking fighting again. You guys are too loud. Your neighbors are fucking complaining. You know? My disease has a vote on not only how I live my life, but who I fucking date. like, that's trippy, man. That is trippy. Like, the fact that, like, it's that cunning, baffling, powerful that, like, I could date someone for 2 years because I'm 51% into drinking right now.
So is it
or hard drugs or coke or meth or whatever the fuck it is.
Is it hard for you when you're, like, starting to date a new girl? Like, or is it, like, cause you can, do you know if you can trust them? Is, like, that what the issue is?
Nah, not even that. I mean,
you don't give a fuck. As long as they leave you alone, I give a fuck. She sucks 20 dicks.
Yep.
What do I give a fuck? Yep. She pays half her rent. She doesn't complain if I drink, if I bring a bottle home.
Yeah.
No, no, I understand that. I was saying, like, now when you date, now, are you worried that you're picking the wrong girl?
That's why they say, like, you know, like, if you're, like, in recovery, like, they go a year without dating. Just go a year without dating, you know? And Joey knows, like, I you know, last time I was sober for 3 years, about 40 days in, started dating Danny Skirts, you know? That went good for, like, 2 years. But then we broke up and shit went bad. And then 8 months later, I was drinking again, you know, because I made her my shit and not, like, being fucking clean my shit. If that makes sense, man, if that makes any sense.
I did what you did, but I went back and forth. I had a woman that was good, then we did drugs, then we both cleaned up, and I didn't really dig it once we cleaned up. And
what do you mean? Like, once you cleaned up, you saw it differently?
I saw it differently.
And that's understandable.
And we broke up, and then it was weird. Like, I liked women that were opposite me. Like, I didn't want to be with somebody who liked blow. I wanted somebody who liked beer. So we both weren't hooked on the same shit. I liked women who got high.
I get
because
that.
Because I liked the sex and the stupid freakiness at night.
Get that, yeah.
But the daytime living with chicks who did blow was a long time because now they're going through the same thing I'm going through.
And now you just both lower the bottom.
So I like those coke chicks.
You don't want any woman
like
with a shovel in her hand.
Right. I didn't want to be.
Let's dig lower.
There's no way. Right. One thing I really made a point of in my life was that always, like, somebody made a dumb remark around me. Why do you hang out with that guy? He doesn't get high. Let's get something fucking straight. To me, that was my refuge. I wanted to hang out with people who didn't get high. When I was getting high, that was part of my healing my addiction. Was part of me being me, that I hung out with people purposely that did not get high. So they didn't know what I was going through. They didn't know the signs. I love that. I love hanging out with people that do not get high because I can't take hanging out with people.
It felt
get
safe
high.
To you.
Yeah, it was my safety valve.
Yeah.
That's always kept me together. I like hanging out with people who don't get high. I like a couple people in my life who don't get high. There's some people who need to get high. That's a complete fucking different story. But there's a lot of people who don't need to get high, and you don't need them to get high. In fact, you hang out, you get a kick out of them.
I'm always curious. I'm curious about them. I'm like, why do you not need to get high? Like, you know, if I'm around a lot of people, I feel like I need to get high. I need something else to get me around these people. But then there are these people that don't need that. And I'm so curious by them that I'm like, how can you be around a lot of other people and still be happy and not be high? Does that make sense?
I respect it. I respect it with all my heart. I have friends that have never gotten high, never touched a fucking thing in their life.
Absolutely.
And I look at those people, and I got all the respect in the world that they didn't fall for the dumb loopholes that I fell for in high school or whatever.
Aren't you curious about that?
Not at all. People have different beliefs. It doesn't matter how your parents raise you. Some people, you know, some people don't like that. Some people get exposed at an early age.
Right.
And just don't like it, you know?
Yeah.
I don't like alcohol. I don't like the effects of a room full of drunks. I don't like it, you know?
Mm-hmm.
It got to the point the last 5 years of my addiction, last 6 or 7 years, I can't lie to you, I couldn't be around people snorting coke with me. If you were abroad and you were definitely going to suck my dick and we were going to have sex,
yeah,
come in. But if not, if you got doubts, if you're not sure, listen, don't waste my time and your time, because I'll throw you out that fucking window.
Right.
You've been chatting me up. I got a headache. I had to hear about your childhood and no blowjob at the end of this fucking tunnel.
Yeah. I mean, I got to know who your manager is.
Yeah, the whole fucking deal. It's,
you got an album coming out?
Right. I was fucking sick. Like, I would not get high with anybody.
Right.
People would come up to me at clubs, man, I got blow. That's great. That's great. I don't do it. And they go, what do you mean? I heard you do. No, I don't do nothing. I would have coke in my pocket. And I'd
say no.
No. And once in a great while, I'd do a bump and have a cocktail at the comedy club, but I'd have to get the fuck out of there.
On the road, too.
On the road, too.
Like, not two around bumps, local no, people, no one can say shit.
No, I don't want to chit-chat.
I would do that, too.
I don't want to chit-chat to nobody.
I would do that, too.
Because that's how they're going to know, and then you got to get chit-chatting, and then no.
I can relate
to
that.
There was no chit-chat. Let me give some shout-outs. We got to get the fuck out of here soon. Not really, but...
Do that. Why you get shout-outs? Can I run and pee while you do
shout-outs? Yeah, go ahead. Okay. Cool. Tammy Rincon. Fabian Fabs Bueno, Thomas Easter, always out there plugging these motherfuckers. Jessuvoir, Jesse James, JT, J Rama, Sean Thompson, The Lifting Game, and Man Stuff for You. How's that, you bad motherfuckers? Don't forget, the Savage Dad Tour starts January 28th in Charlotte, and the following week, February 4th, at the St. Louis Helium. You understand me? Tickets on sale. I don't know. Do what you need to fucking do. I'm just telling you.
You redid your website. Looks good.
Yeah, it looks very nice. Scott did a great job with it. Scott's a fucking savage.
I haven't seen Scott for a while.
He was in town. I think he's coming back, he said, at the end of January.
Oh, my God.
What's up, dog? How you feeling?
I'm good.
It's fucking Thursday. It's a beautiful night to be alive. We're telling some fucking fucking addiction stories. And there you are.
But what about, like...
Hold on. What were you saying? I had a stretch.
Oh, this is what I wanted to ask you.
Yeah.
Was it hard to sleep in prison? Like, when you said you took a nap in prison... I wanted to ask, but the conversation went a different way. Like, when you said you took a nap in prison, I was like, how the fuck do you take a nap with, like, murderers walking around? Like, that was crazy to me.
All right, in county jail, there's two guys to a cell.
That's still too much.
All right. When you lock the door.
I would totally go to isolation. Right. I would, there's
then
no way.
When you get to, like, when I got to the other place, it was one man cells. And they locked the door at night. And then when I got to whatever the fuck, diagnostic, it's a one man cell. It's an iron bed, pretty much. You put a sheet on a metal fucking bed.
Jesus.
And you slept, Lee. You just sleep. What are you going to do? You got to sleep.
But the one that freaked me out was the one, like, the camp. Because you said you were in, like, an open air area, right?
Yeah, you were in an open area. Holy but still, shit, you have a door to your room.
Did it lock?
No.
No, fuck that.
I don't remember.
Oh, my God. Like, I've thought about it, and I would, like, punch a guard, whatever you have to do. I would totally get isolation. I'd be fine.
No,
there's no way.
No, you don't. No way. It's not as bad as people fucking think. They show American movies to scare you and shit. It's just men trying to get their lives together. Listen, when you come that close, when you're in a camp, you're so close. Any smart guy goes, you know what? I got a family now. I got a second chance. I'm going to mind my business. A lot of guys mind their fucking business in those camps. They don't say two fucking words because they know they're that much closer to being home. There's guys that are going to be fuck-ups anyway, and eventually they get caught. A bunch of guys in there got regressed. That means they catch you with a dirty UA. There's snitches at those places. So the snitches got their ear out. So the snitches, every time they find out about a party, they go right to the guards and go test those guys. You follow me how it works? So you have to be very careful. The prison knows who the snitches are. They don't talk much about them. If not, those guys will have you pissed. You know how many times I got pissed the whole time I was in the system?
How many?
Zero. Not one fucking time. Once I got to the halfway house, they pissed me every time I walked in because they knew I was a fucking creepster. What's up, Jayson? You're almost on a year.
Yeah, man. Like 2-3 weeks away.
What advice do you have for somebody who made a resolution? Who said, this is it, I'm not doing pills no more? Because I got a lot of emails the last 2 weeks about people saying, you know.
I would say this, man. I would say,
do they need
just
a rehab?
Today, man. Just, you know, not everybody. Not everybody. Probably 15%, 20% of them might. But you know how you find out if you do? You go like this, man. I'm going to not, you know, I'm going to hit the pillow today, like, clean. And if I can do that, you know, for a couple weeks in a row, then I can do it for more. And it's like we said earlier, man, it's like, you know, I had this notion, like, I'm like, I have a problem with surrendering, you know? Because they're like, oh, man, you got to surrender because you're a fucking addict or a drunk or whatever the fuck. And I'm like, wow, man, I'm not good at surrendering. Well, I had no problem surrendering my driver's license, my apartment, my relationship with my girlfriend, my relationship with my family. Like, I'm awesome at surrendering. You know what I mean? It's like surrendering to what? So it's like sometimes you just got to go like, all right, man, I'm fucked. So, all right, then today only. Just like the way I drank, man. It's like the way I drank. I drank for today. I wasn't worried about the future. I wasn't worried about tomorrow. I wasn't worried about shit. I had to get fucked up today. And I'll worry about tomorrow when tomorrow happens. So it's like, have that same sense of urgency. And if you cannot do that, you might need to look at rehab. Because there are people that can do that and get sober. And they go, man, I was just like that far away from needing rehab. Because I almost couldn't do that. But if you can't fucking surrender daily for 30 days and be like, man, I'm fucked. Like, I cannot, like, I have to not drink for 30 days and see what's up. If you can't do it, rehab. You know? And you'll lower the bar, you know? Everyone's bottom is different. You know? So you might have to lower the bar. You might, you know, shit might have to get really, really, really bad before you say fuck it. But the two most dangerous words I can hear in my head, fuck it. When I hear fuck it, I'm in deep shit, dude. When I hear fuck it in between my ears, when I hear in between my ears the two words, fuck it, nothing good has ever happened to me immediately after I hear those two words. So when I hear fuck it, I have to get into action. Because if I don't, it goes the other way, man. You know? Within 6 months, I'm in jail bragging about how good the fucking chocolate chip pancakes are over at San Quentin.
I've been there. Oh, my God, tremendous. You know what I mean? Sunday mornings, Lee, you'd sit there and go, oh, my God.
Yeah. That person heard fuck it 1 year earlier. That person heard fuck it in his head and didn't take a positive action. And a year later, he's bragging to some newbie in some sort of jail about how good the fucking pancakes are at some other fucking intake at some other fucking jail in some other fucking county. Fuck. When you hear fuck it, man, you know, get into fucking action.
You ever hear fuck it, Lee?
You know what, guy? You always feel like a... Or I always felt like a dick here thinking this, but I want to... Because, Joe, you lost a lot of weight. Obviously, the results aren't necessarily as bad or as bad quickly. Like, you're not going to go to jail for getting fat. But I could really relate to a lot of what you said. To a lot of what you said, I really related to. And I think... Because I know there's a lot of fucking big people listening to this show. And, like people always look down on you. And I used to get pissed off. Like, I used to get pissed when, like, people I used to... When I came out here and people I would work with go drink in the middle of the day.
Yeah.
And fucking... Do all
I love
that
day
stuff.
Drinking.
And
I love
or,
day drinking.
Or drinking like at work, and to me, like, and I was looked down upon because I was fat because I ate fucking cheeseburgers, and it used to piss me off, and to me, it was like, obviously it's not the same hardness, but like sticking to a diet, and that's what I wanted to ask you, Joe, is like, if like there's times where you would go fuck it, or it's hard to like when you're that big, when you're that far gone.
Yeah, but it's like if you fuck up, it's like if you're on a diet and then you have one day where you fuck up, you don't go, because your head goes, hey man, we fucked up, so fuck it.
Yeah, yeah.
Let's kick over the sandcastle. But there's part of you that's like, if you fuck up, cool man, I fucked up yesterday. Let's say yesterday I got fucking hammered last night. I could drink for another fucking year and a half and really fuck my life up. Or I can go, you know what? Yesterday I drank, and I'm right back on the fucking wagon again. It's same thing with diets, man. Same thing with working out. Same thing with jujitsu. Same thing with fucking comedy. Same thing with everything. You know? It's like progress, not perfection.
Yeah.
And everyone's like, and whatever is killing you, whatever your Achilles heel is like, we're either perfect or we're fucked. And the opposite of that is true. It's like, I'm progressing.
If I was going to start a diet, and it was like, I'm gonna start Monday, and like, let's say I fucked up Monday morning, I'd be like, oh, well, I should just start Monday, next Monday.
I'll start in February. Yeah, I'll start in February. It's January 9th. I fucked up on Monday, so I'll start in February. And you grant yourself 20 fucking 4 days of fucking up and developing bad habits versus going, you know what? I fucked up yesterday. Today I'm going to restart.
The fucking guy in Sunset next to the El Compadre, he is a Taekwondo school, a Subakdo school.
I know exactly. I used to live right behind it.
And I used to go to that Subakdo school all the time, you know. And when I first joined, I went for like a month, and then the cocaine took over. It was too rough. The plan was to go there, and that would keep me out of coke till 7:45.
Yeah, I love you.
But 6:45 to 7:45, that's the big phone hours for blow. That's when your phone's blowing
especially with pager days.
Yeah, that's fucking, you know.
Of course, that's 911.
And I stopped going. I remember I bumped into him. He goes, how you doing? He goes, listen, don't be embarrassed. He goes, I just want to tell you something. What's going on? I'm like, I go on the road. I don't have time. And he goes, so what days are you home? I go, Sunday, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday. He goes, come Tuesday at 10, once a week. He goes, I guarantee you, if you start just coming once a week, within a year, you'll be there twice a week.
Momentum.
And it worked. And that's how I started losing weight, by going to the gym once a week. You know, I just go once a week.
And it's like a blind faith, too.
Yeah, it's like a fucking little thing. And next thing you know, one will become two. And then next thing you know, you meet a buddy there who says, hey, you coming on Tuesday? Yeah, I'll come on Tuesday. You're going to come on Tuesday? Yeah.
And even trippier is all of a sudden you'll meet people under you, almost like a period scheme, where they're like, hey, man, I don't want to do this. And you're like, hey, man, just do it once a week. And you're saying the shit that was told to you, you know? And now you're not, you know, you're a link in a chain, you know? And it's like somebody above you who knows more than you is giving you knowledge, but you're also passing that down to people who are less than you.
Paula has been taking some of the classes at the gym, and she said, like, right now it's really busy with people who are doing resolutions. And she said she wanted to talk to this one girl because she could see how, like, scared she was. But Paula was like, I wouldn't know how to do that. And the first time I worked out, this chubby black dude on a bike, like, I was doing a bike because the elliptical was too much after like 15 minutes.
Mm-hmm.
Was like, we were just next to each other, and Paula could already do the elliptical for the entire time. So she left while I was doing the bike, and he, as soon as she left, he like was like, hey man, how long have you been doing it? I've been doing it for this long. I lost this much weight, and just keep coming. And like, and you told me like it was gonna happen, and then it happened like the next day, or like right
people
around that
know.
Time.
People know. People sense
that's it. What I just said. I just said, be like, hey, just talk
that
to me.
That I will say. That, you know,
people will
you know
sense
what I got
it.
The
good
most
people.
In like
solid
the last
people.
11 months? Hey, man, what'd you do? You cut your hair? Did you shave? You put on some weight? Like, you lose some weight? You been going to the gym? Everything they guess is not what it is, because it's like an inside job. You know, like, what I did was I just quit drinking. That's all I did. Focus a little more on myself. Focus a little more on my art, my craft, being present, being there for my friends, apologizing more, admitting when I'm wrong more. The little things that, you know, what I'm doing dictates. But no one can guess what it is. It's like, hey, man, you look different, man. You got a different fucking glow.
That's
about
fucking
you.
Fucking crazy.
Because it's an inside fucking job. You know, like we were talking the other night, and you and I had a long talk about a lot of different things. We were hanging out in the kitchen. Like a few different times, you're just like, there you are. You know, you look at I was drinking a coffee, I remember. And you just, I'd notice you look at the coffee. You know how many times I've noticed people look at what's in my hand? It's like, hey, man, this guy seems like he's in a good mood. You know, subconsciously. Last year of my life, every time I seen T-Bone in a good mood, it's because he lit up. Seems like he's in a good mood. Let me look at his drink. Oh, man, he's just drinking coffee. Now I wonder what's going on.
How good is that coffee?
It's trippy, man. It's trippy to just be at a place, at least for the moment, where I'm like, man, I'm cool right now. I'm cool just being in the kitchen talking to Joey Diaz. Before, if I was on blow, if I was smoking, you know, if I was fucking smoked a joint, if I had 9 Jack and Cokes in me, I might be in front of you. I might be listening to you talk, but I'm like, you know, I gotta get that next fix. You know, where am I going? I'm not present. But then me and you are standing there by that freezer, present, talking as fuck. You know, but I still am at that point. So I look forward to, like, and look, I've earned it. Might take me a year or two before people stop looking at my drink. You know what I mean? Oh, man. Oh, shit. Okay, you just got a coffee. Oh, I just got a hot tea. Oh, I just got a Coke. You know, my friend, you know Jackie Gold?
No.
Ah, she's funny. She's a funny comic. Female friend of mine. She'll always, every time she comes up, if I'm drinking a Coke, she's like, she'll smell it. Bobby Lee, too.
Does that bother you?
No, because both of them, we have that joke. So I remember like 2 years ago, Bobby Lee goes, what are you doing, man? What are you doing? I'm like, no, man, cool. He goes, cool. You're cool? Let me take a drink. Because Bobby's sober. Let me take a drink of your drink. I go, man, you don't want to drink that. What are you doing, man? That was Bobby.
Bobby's still sober all yeah. these years.
He's oh, yeah, really he's doing great. Bobby's doing great. He's actually very pivotal. Bobby, Tate Fletcher, there's a lot of people that are very pivotal in what I'm trying to do with my life. And now he's like, you know, he'll just come up, he'll just like take a sip of my Coke just to be funny. Because he knows I won't stop him. And my friend Jackie, she'll be like, let me smell your Coke before I drink it. It's like an inside joke, you know. Because a year and a half ago, you know, Bobby couldn't drink that drink. But I'd be playing it off like he could. I'm lying to everybody. But Bobby knew. You know? It's like, it's accountability. It's like that sort of thing. So it's like, yeah, man, it will, you know, in answer to your question, in a year-ish, I'll notice when people stop looking at my drink. You know?
Would it be hard? Because you were talking with Joey, so you were, like, engaged. But if you were just in there next to a bar, would it be, is it weird for you?
No, same thing, man. I mean, people last night was like, oh, it's hard to be in a bar where everyone's drinking. Man, it's hard for me to be in an insurance seminar anywhere.
Yeah.
You know, there's going to be a million times, like, you know, I know every bar right around this corner. Like, if I wanted to go drink right now, no one can stop me but me. Like, I have to want this lifestyle.
I remember people used to say, well, what are your triggers? When I get up in the morning, I get triggers.
The weather? Being awake?
Everything triggered me. A movie, yep. A dish I ate.
It's a windy day, and I romanticize drink. You know, anything will trigger me because that's my trick. You know, my trigger is being conscious.
Well, both of you have said you've had, like, you had friends, you were friends with all the bartenders, and you were friends with Coke dealers.
Sure.
But, like, how can you call them friends if when they know that you're trying to be sober, they serve you?
Because it's not their fault.
Not their fault.
They're doing their job. They're just them. I come into their lives, they don't come into mine. You know? I seek them out, they don't seek me out. So as I become friends with them to get what I want, it's not their fault that I no longer need what they can give me. If that makes sense.
You know, Lee, out of the four Coke dealers I had, two of them, we just spoke over the holidays and New Year's, and the one sent me a Christmas card. And the one called me, I called him, and he called really? Back. And the black guy called me and he goes, you know, you're one of my favorite motherfuckers. He goes, I don't just call anybody on motherfucking Christmas.
Right.
But till this day, you're one of my favorite motherfuckers in the world. So we always talk. When I'm by his house, I always call him. He'll call me and ask me if I have a spot at the store and come to the store and see me. And we don't even discuss cocaine. I give him a hug and he leaves. Yep.
I got a buddy like that.
It's too. Amazing. No. I don't. He didn't do anything.
Remember coaching horses?
Yeah,
that used to be back in the day, that was a big Coke, late 90s, that was a Coke spot. And my dealer used to be there, and you and I were talking, we were in the kitchen. I'm like, I could see that guy right now, and I haven't done Coke in a while, but I could see that guy and still have to take a shit. If I'm walking around Farmer's Market, 3rd and Fairfax, I see fucking English Dave walking up. I see him. I haven't seen him in 3 years. I automatically have to take a shit. Just because I bought so much Coke from that dude that my body assimilates. Eye contact with this guy. I have to take a shit because I'm about to do Coke.
No. When I see these guys, I don't even think about it anymore. Like, I don't even think about it at all anymore. At all. I couldn't even have seen my life there. Ever copping that life, talking to those people, ever. I was thinking of an interesting thing. When I was 22, I remember being in the worst spot in my life, and I'd be at this bar every night and saying...
What do you mean, worst spot of your life?
You know, I was just a young kid, confused, didn't know where I was going, and I was scared, but the coke and the life covered all that fear. I was just living my life.
Right.
And I would hang out at this bar, and I would look at these people, and I despised these people. I despised what they stood for. I despised everything about them. And I used to have to hang there. This was my headquarters
right.
at that age. You know, you're at a bar waiting for, dog, you're not going to believe this. My friend just bumped into a guy who has 80 Quaaludes. He wants to sell them for $2 a piece. And there you, this is what you wait
for. You're at your home club.
You're at your home club. Right. You're waiting for people to come to you with different bullshit stories. And I remember looking around one day going, I can't wait till I never have to go into it. At 22, I knew I had an addiction.
I think I did right around the same age.
At 29, I came to grips with it.
25.
Once I went to jail and came out and went through the shit I went through and still love cocaine more than when I went in, after you do time for coke and you come out and still want to get high, you go, you know what? This is the deal. This is what I'm going to do. I'm going to get a job. I'm going to do my work, but three nights a week, I'm going to blast off for $50. And that's what I came to terms with. I wasn't going to wrestle anymore. I was sick and tired of doing coke and going, that's the last time, and ripping up the envelope and then going back into the garbage and getting it out and snorting salt that I threw away. I was done with that shit. On the lighter side, I got to ask you something. What's going on with Punch Drunk Sports? Talk to me.
Punch Drunk is great, and especially now that Ari is back in town. He's here till like March, I think. So it'll be all three of us in the studio, which is great. We got a lot of big bets that have to be paid off. Ari gets to use a fart funnel and fart in Sam's mouth next week.
What was the bet for that?
I think it was a college NCAA finals in basketball. Sam lost.
So this is going on next week in Punch Drunk, next Tuesday at 12 o'clock.
In 2 weeks, not this weeks. Next one, but the one after
I might
that.
Show up with Lee and a special black friend, guest friend of mine.
No, you will not. No, you will not.
Let's do it. It's time.
Anytime, man.
Lee gets a fart in the mouth.
When can you do the show? When can you? When are you ever free on
this? If you bring Tuesday. The fart funnel in 2 weeks, tell Ari to get 2 fart funnels and we'll be there.
Oh, thank you for leaving me on my own.
Tuesday. You're going to make Lee get one on?
Lee has had to have a fart in the mouth.
No.
For 10 really? Years, a chick, a black chick.
No one's going to do it.
A chick from Colorado sent a picture.
We have a whole system set up. It's basically like a beer, you know, a beer bong.
There you go.
Oh, I hate you so much.
So you put the beer bong end in your mouth.
We're
going to tape the funnel around an asshole.
No.
And then they have to eat like bad fish, smoke a couple bad cigars, a couple 12 packs of things that just say beer. Like just eat horrible things for 24 hours. And then they fucking fart in your mouth, and then you have to hit the beer bong, but like it's a bong. You have to hold the fart in, hold it in, and then you have to exhale it.
We'll be there with Lisa. Yeah.
out of the country.
Noon to 2 on allthingscomedy.com.
She told me she'll take $300, but I got to make sure she takes PayPal.
Fly Energy Radio will now be based out of Tel Aviv.
What's that?
I'm going to go to Tel Aviv now.
Lee, you've been owing this to the fans.
No, I haven't.
You owe it. If you owe it,
Lee, you don't understand. I have a family. You have fans.
If we can do a cross-promotion podcast with you getting a fucking fart in your mouth and Sam getting one in his mouth.
Why don't you open up the ear with a fart in your mouth from the hot
I'm not doing it in the mouth. I'll do it in the face. I'm not putting it in the fucking...
So wait a second.
I'm not going to puke. I'll only puke if I can bird it to you. That's so gross.
Small commitments become big commitments.
No, that's not a commitment.
So hold on. What you're telling me is... You won't take the fart in the mouth, but you'll take the fart to the eyeball.
No, not to the eyeball.
Well, where's she gonna fart? Where do you want?
Nowhere. She's not gonna fart anywhere.
Oh, right over the nose. Whatever that Jew nose.
Where are you gonna do? Hire a black hooker?
No, she's a nice girl. She just eats a lot. She loves Popeye's chicken.
Yeah.
So she'll fart in your face. Oh my God. It's over. Or how about we give you the small deuce and she farts and you suck the fart in your tube?
$200.
$250.
Oh my God.
We'll do a GoFundMe. We'll do a GoFundMe for Lee to get a fart to the mouth.
Yep.
No, because they're gonna do it. I'm not doing that.
What would you take? $10,000 to fart to the face?
No. $10,000, I'll murder my mother for $10,000.
What do you need the GoFundMe to be for you to take like a tremendous fart to the face?
Great question.
What would it need to be? What's the number?
What's the number?
Yeah.
What are the parameters?
You fart in your mouth and you hit it like you're taking a bong rip.
I'm not doing the mouth.
No, take it like a bong rip, hold it in your lungs, and exhale out a fart.
There's no number for the mouth. If you want to discuss the face, that could be right.
You exhale a fart out of your lungs.
No. I'd rather kill myself. That's terrible. It's the worst thing I've ever heard anyone do.
Well, Sam Tripoli has to do it in 2 weeks on PunchDrunkSports.com on All Things Comedy Network, Tuesdays from noon to two. Ari Shaffir is going to tape a fucking beer funnel to his butthole. And Sam's going to hit it like a bong.
Oh, what is Ari going to eat before?
A lot of horrible things, apparently.
I want this chick to eat like Popeyes and get sick, like get food poisoning. And then you lay on the table and she just farts and whatever comes out of her muffler.
Pot of coffee, three cigars.
Why not? It's a party.
She's going to shit on you.
If you're not going to be like...
She might shit in a hose that's connected to your nose, but it doesn't mean it gets to your nose.
No one's
gonna. Listen, you guys want the secret to New Year's resolutions? Make the first step real easy. Like the first thing you do every day, you got to put on underwear. This year, out with the old, in with the new. Those old fucking crusty things with the yellow around your ball sack, light those motherfuckers on fire. Step into a new, fresh pair of MeUndies, the world's most comfortable underwear. And it's the easiest resolution you'll make. Head to MeUndies.com right now. Choose from a variety of styles and limited edition patterns for both men and women. That's the secret of MeUndies. And they'll be delivered right to your door. No bullshit. Right to your door. I got a package from MeUndies yesterday. Some stockings. If I was a burglar, I'd be on fire. MeUndies is the next level of underwear. Every pair is made with their signature Modal fabric, proven to be twice as soft as cotton. They absorb sweat. I'm telling you, MeUndies is the motherfucking future. They don't just feel better than regular undies. They make you feel invincible, like you got a fucking firecracker up your ass and you hang out with Sonny Chew. And it's guaranteed to be the most comfortable underwear you've ever worn, or your first pair is on the fucking house gratis. So don't start your new year in that old, rusty, fucking disgusting underwear. You pick up a chick and your dick smells like dick. Make a change and head to MeUndies.com right now /Joey. Right now, and get 20% off your first order. And listen, as always, free fucking shipping in the U.S. and Canada. It's on us. So for 20% off your first order and the world's most comfortable underwear, head to MeUndies, all right? 20% off, cocksuckers. And while we're talking about deals, guess who's back? Nature Box, bitches!
What?
That's who's motherfucking back. The church is brought to you by NatureBox.com. You deserve better than high fructose corn syrup or red dye number 578. I don't know no red dye 578. NatureBox snacks taste delicious without any high fructose corn syrup, trans fat, MSG, artificial colors, sweeteners, flavors, none of that crap. Red sounds like Chinese food. NatureBox makes finding a range of options, from healthy to indulgent, easy. They combine unique flavors with ingredients you can't pronounce, like the ones I fucked up, to create great snacks when you want to share. From sriracha roasted cashews to peanut butter nom noms, Nature Box has over 100 seriously delicious options to choose from, all delivered, again, right to your door. And you'll never get bored with NatureBox.com snacks, because every single month they release new snacks to choose from, like aged cheddar lentil loops or garlic bread cheese crisps. Tremendous shit. Say goodbye to the weird mystery ingredients and start snacking confidently with NatureBox, okay? Visit NatureBox.com/Joey to get, listen, ready for this? 50% off your first order.
That's better nom noms, you dumb fox.
50%. Head to naturebox.com right now /Joey and that's get the 50%. Right snacks for 2016. One last time, that's naturebox.com/Joey for 50% off your first box of delicious, high quality snacks sent directly to your doorstep.
They added peanut butter nom noms?
Yeah, just make sure you got no fucking thieves in the neighborhood, because then you're going to be calling me. And as usual, listen, flu season is here.
I've been sick since Sunday.
Yeah, no, and thank you for coming in, Kyle. You should have told me on the phone. I would have sent you to fucking CBS.
No, yesterday is the first day I was good. Today's the second day I was good.
So do me a favor. Go to Honor.com right now. You're starting new resolutions. You want to be in shape. You want to feel better. Even if you just drink the protein powder, which I drank today without a banana, it was fucking delicious. The chocolate, the cocoa, you'll never taste the chocolate that's better and sweeter than that stuff. Amazing. 32 grams of protein, 2 scoops, all right? They also have Shroom Tech Sports, Shroom Tech Immune. I mean, I love so many of the stuff they have. You know, whether it's the Alpha brand. Listen, do me a favor. Go to Honored.com. Read. Look, I could tell you a bunch of stuff, but it's I don't know what you want. I don't know what goals you have. I don't know what you're trying to do. Go to Honored.com. Whatever you're trying to do, they'll fucking help you supplement-wise. And to help you even more, I'm going to give you 10% off your first order. So what do they do, Lee? They go in there and press church. C-H-U-R-C-H. Is that correct?
That's correct, Amundo.
What's the correct Amundo?
Church.
Spell it.
C-H-U-R-C-H.
There you go, you bad motherfuckers. Go to Honored.com and press church and get 10% off your first order. And again, like Nature Box, like me on these, everything gets delivered to your door. That's the simplicity of dealing with Uncle Joey. I don't make it tough for you. I don't have to pick nothing up. But look, who is it? UPS. And they just leave it there, right? That's it. That's what you want. You don't want people bothering. I want to thank Jayson Thibault. Don't forget to listen to him on Punch Drunk Sports on Tuesday. Yep. I want to thank my main man, Lee Syatt, here fucking high as ever. He needs a fucking rehab. An exorcism. He's a little perverted Jew. That's why I love him now. Thibault, I'm proud of you. Almost one fucking year. I wanted to have you come back and do reports and talk to people.
Anytime.
Because people are going through this, man.
And I'll
say
this. Last time I did this show, I got hit up by a lot of people that were like, hey, man, I really related to what you had to say and blah, blah, blah.
Fuck yeah.
And a lot of them I've continued friendships with and we've talked. If anybody just needs someone to fucking rap to about this sort of, you know, what we're talking about, which is serious shit, at the Thibault on Twitter, you know, mention me that. I'll follow you so we can DM or, you know, Facebook, Jayson Thibault, any of that shit, man. Just, you'll find me. And, you know, if I can do anything to help you have what was so freely given to me, I'm your guy, man.
Thank you very much for putting that off. And now you got no more excuses, cocksucker. Now you got no excuses, all right? Lee, I love you. We'll see you motherfuckers Sunday and Monday. We'll be back like herpes. Thank Jayson Thibault. I want to thank my man, the Flying Jew, Uncle Joey here. We love you. What's the email? Church.com. If I get them, they go to different fucking places. Yeah, church.com on Gmail. Church
of what's happening now, pod@gmail.com.
That's it right there. Send me an email. Amazon.com. Whatever the fuck you want
to do. Again.
Uncle Joey's here. I love you.
I love both of you guys. Thank you for having me, man.
What?
Can I have those papers?
What papers? The papers. I need the papers, Joey.